Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the 2022 Jamie Rumble Memorial Lecture by Professor Dimitris Plantzos. It's a great privilege to welcome you on behalf of the Center for Hellenic Studies and Department of Classics here at King's, but also on behalf of the Courtauld Institute of Art next door and the Institute of Classical Studies. My name is Michael Squire, and I teach in the Department of Classics, and the Rumble Lecture is one of the highlights of our academic year. Before getting to the main event, I wanted to do two things. First, to say something briefly about the Rumble Lecture and the Rumble Fund and why it means so much to us here at King's, and then to introduce our speaker, Dimitris, and tell you a little bit about why we're so excited to have him as this year's Rumble Lecturer. The Rumble Fund was founded in 2013 by an alumnus of our classical archaeology program here at King's. Its main purpose is to sponsor student trips to Mediterranean lands, above all Greece and to Italy. Those trips are paid for by the Department of Classics and to the fund, and they're integrated within our taught modules within the department. They're an opportunity to take our students to the very places where and which we study here at King's. And of course, in London, we have all manner of opportunities to really get hands-on with classical antiquities. But what the Rumble Fund does is allow us to actually take students to the very sites that they're studying. At this point in an introduction, I would normally show you pictures of the latest Rumble Fund trip. But of course, the pandemic of the last 2 years has scuppered that idea, putting paid to well-made plans to take students to Greece and to Italy. Here you can see the last Rumble trip in 2019, where Professor Honda van Steen, the director for the Centre for Hellenic Studies, took our students to Rhodes. Over the last almost 10 years, students have enjoyed all manner of antiquities in both Greece and in Italy, and they've tweeted and Instagrammed their passioned and passionate responses to what they've seen. It's brilliant that here tonight we can actually have the Rumble Fund lecture in person for the first time for 3 years. But it's also brilliant to know that our students will be heading back to Greece in the next academic year, where they'll be going to Athens in the context of a module on adventures in Greek drama, led once again by Honda van Steen. The Rumble Fund itself came about thanks to that donation by our alumnus, Sandra Rosignoli, and it's great that Sandra is able to be here tonight. But it was named after a close personal friend of our donor, Jamie Rumble. Jamie wasn't at King's, nor did he study classics, but he was passionate about the idea of equal opportunities and that everyone should have the chance to shine. Jamie's own life was cut short in February 1995 at the tender age of just 26, not much older than the majority of our students. He died after a brave battle with pancreatic cancer. We at King's are very proud of the fund that was set up in his name, and we hope that Jamie would have been too. Well, my second task tonight is to introduce Dimitris and to explain a little bit about the context of his research that we're going to be hearing about tonight. Dimitris is professor of the National and Kapodistrian University of Athens, and before that, he was assistant professor at the University of Ioannina, and he was also a curator at the Museum of Psychedelic Art between 1998 and 2002. Dimitris has strong links to the British academic and research scene. He did his PhD in Oxford, where he also did his British Academy postdoctoral fellowship. And Dimitris also has very close links with the Rumble Fund. And one of the things that's wonderful about having Dimitris here tonight is that our students heard Dimitris in Athens in 2 years, 2014, the very first Rumble trip, and 2018, where he talked, amongst other things, about the crypto-colonialism of the classical past in contemporary Greece. It would take me much too long to run through all of Dimitris's articles and books, but here are some selected highlights. First of all, his Hellenistic Engraved Gems book of 1999, based on his research at the University of Oxford, along with more recent monographs like the Greek Art and Archaeology book, first published in 2011 in Greek, and then republished in Greek and in English in 2016, and of course his book on the art of painting in ancient Greece in 2018. And one of the few highlights of COVID was the fact that the American School of Classical Studies turned the research of that book into a webinar that was watched all over the world by classical archaeology enthusiasts. Along the way, Dimitris has translated ancient works, not least the Imagines or Icones of Philostratus, a text close to my own heart, and he's also edited and co-edited a number of volumes, including a landmark Companion to Greek Art in 2012, 2008 Banarchy Museum book on singular antiquity, archaeology and Hellenic identity in 20th century Greece, and another festschrift, this time 1999, on classicism to neoclassicism. He's on countless journal and academic boards, including the Journal of Modern Greek Studies, the Journal of Greek Media and Culture, and the Athens University Review of Archaeology. He also has hands-on archaeological experience, directing or co-directing, amongst others, the Argos Orestikon project. Innovative intellectual projects have also led to close collaborations with other institutions and cities. And I'm thinking here, amongst other things, of his 2019 project on the construction of knowledge in archaeology and art history in southeastern Europe, based, I think, at the University of Sofia. In all this, what really sets Dimitris's research apart isn't just an expertise in classical art and archaeology, but an abiding interest in what that legacy means to the contemporary world, above all, to the contemporary world of Greece. The world of political identity and cultural identity, but also the question of why and how this material should matter. And with that in mind, Dimitris, I think that's precisely the kind of theme that we're going to be hearing about more tonight. So without more of ado, let me say how very much we're all looking forward to hearing your lecture, Acropolis Adieu, Popular Images of Greece in the 1950s and 60s.
Thank you very much for this very warm and generous introduction. And of course, thank you and Professor Van Steen for this invitation. It is a great honor to be standing in front of you this evening. So I'm extremely grateful to my hosts, to the foundation, but also to all of you who are here this evening. These are indeed trying times, both for Greece and classical art, but also for this country and this university is indeed my own. So I would like first and foremost to thank the organizers of this event for their effort and perseverance, and of course, all of you who are present here. My topic today will be images of Greece as a tourism landscape in the 1950s and the 1960s. We all remember how, in the very beginning of our century, international advertising campaigns aimed at reinventing Greece as a tourist destination, promoting the country as a place where ancient myths are still alive and ready to be relived pretty much by anyone. Although, however, for most of us, those myths Greece is asking us to relive seem to be taking us back to Odysseus and his Ithaca, Achilles and his heel, or even Theseus and his Minotaur, not to mention Oedipus and his mummy issues, I find that what present-day tourists to the country are, in fact, asked to relive is the glory that was Greece of the 1950s and the 1960s, at least as portrayed in the movies and the songs that went with them. And it is with one song that I would like to begin my lecture today, not a song from a movie as such, but quite film-like in its own way. In her 1971 hit, Acropolis Adieu, first sung in German, French chanteuse Mireille Mathieu relates the sad yet inevitable departure of a young man from Athens and his melancholic farewell to the city and its cardinal monument. Acropolis Adieu, I would have liked very much to stay. Acropolis Adieu. I must now leave. Let us listen to the song. Written by Christian Brunn and Georg Buschor, the song belongs to a distinctive trend in European songwriting of the 1960s and early 1970s, following the phenomenal success of certain films from and about Greece from those years, notably Jules Dassin's Never on Sunday from 1960 and Michael Kakoyannis's Zorba the Greek from 1964. Music for the two films, written by Manos Hadzidakis and Mikis Theodorakis, respectively, Greece's most eminent composers of the post-war period, became an instant hit worldwide. Hadzidakis even got an Oscar for Never on Sunday's title song, which was widely covered across the globe and especially in Europe. From France, Les Enfants du Piret, performed by Dalida, to Italy, Uno a te, Uno a me, performed by Milva, and Germany, Ein Schiff wird kommen, performed by Lalle Andersen, to Poland and what at the time were Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia, where it was recorded in Croatian, in Serbian, and Slovenian. In all these films and songs, Greece is presented as a romanticized travel destination inhabited by naive yet blindingly sexy girls and even more naive men who are usually portrayed as a cross between an idiot savant and a plain brute. And of course, all this against a background of classical art, mostly represented by ruined temples and mutilated statues, and needless to add, with the Acropolis as a centerpiece. Acropolis Adieu, on the other hand, was reincarnated in French, Acropolis Adieu, in English, Goodbye, My Love, and Spanish, Acropolis Adios. In it, too, Greece is depicted as an exotic paradise for melancholic lovers who must part from one another when September comes. But who is the boy's lover in the song? Who asks him if and when will he ever be back? To whom is he answering, maybe never again? Although the questions are posed by a female, he seems to be replying only to the Acropolis itself, perhaps also gendered female here. Is the Acropolis the young traveler's summer lover, posing the persistent questions? Or does he see his real girlfriend as a personification of the Acropolis? In any case, within the song's happy-go-lucky universe, this does not make much difference. Come, let's dance. Let us forget any worries is the answer to this end of summer tristesse. Acropolis can wait. Can it though? The song's English language version, Goodbye My Love, contains no questions, though the same melancholy may be discerned. I won't forget those summer nights, by candlelight, the golden days together, and so on. Here again, the boy seems to be bidding farewell to the Acropolis, though a girl may be lurking between the lines. In every version of the song, therefore, Greece is constructed as a world apart, somewhat eccentric, though regrettably backward, a place to visit, yet certainly also a place to leave behind. A landscape of ancient glories and modern distractions from modernity itself, a land defined by its own separatedness, its quasi-feminine penetrability, its supine malleability. We made love to one another for a bit. Acropolis, adieu. In the previous paragraph, I just took the liberty to quote freely from Edward Said's Orientalism, precisely since I find that his view that Europe has systematically feminized the Orient since early modernity particularly applies to Greece, since the first Westerner ever set foot to the land of the Greeks, the Western gaze, always gendered male, has been seeing the entire country, including its inhabitants, as part of the Orient, a place isolated from the mainstream of European history, as a locale requiring Western attention, reconstruction, even redemption. What I find fascinating is that as a metonymy for Greece and Greekness, classical art, mostly represented by ruins, is time and again deployed both as praise and criticism for the country and its people. Especially since the Greek financial collapse in 2010 and the bailout deals that followed it, classical art has been systematically used to illustrate the structural weaknesses of the Greek economy, or to sustain stereotypical accusations of negligence and irresponsibility of the modern Greeks, a charge often alluding to their Mediterranean way of life, whatever that is. One, however, these songs and movies hasten to point out. Indeed, if anyone in the audience would like to understand what this Greek way of life is all about, they do not really need to ask any Greeks. They don't even need to visit the country itself. They can just watch the plate-breaking scenes from Never on Sunday to get a pretty clear definition. Is Greece's financial situation worsened and austerity measures were taking their toll of unemployment, living standards, and the welfare state, mock images borrowed from the classical archive kept reappearing as if in order to explain and legitimize Greek suffering. Funny as it may have looked to use images from antiquity to further a current political discussion, it also seemed to work. Crumbling buildings and broken statues were time and again enlisted to convince a global audience that, on the one hand, Greek economy was in a shape as bad as the country's classical temples, and on the other, that the Greeks were as useless in curating their cultural heritage as in the balancing of their books, or, of course, the other way round. Along these lines, the German weekly news magazine Der Spiegel featured in May 2012 a cover reminding its readership of Mireille Mathieu's by then long forgotten hit in order to argue that it was time for the Greeks to leave the Eurozone. The composite image on the cover showed a classical looking ruin, a collapsing Atlantis of sorts with broken Ionic columns and a shattered Euro coin, its shards thrown on the ground. A classical paradise turned into modernity's purgatory or worse. Classical art, indeed, the classical ruin par excellence, was once again used as a metonymy for Greece, at once feminized and excluded in order to justify modern Greece's very marginalization. So, although this tonight is not going to be a lecture about Orientalism or the political feminization of the Orient in particular, I turned to Acropolis Adieu, the song, as an example from Greece's recent cultural history by way of an introduction to my discussion of 20th century international images from and of Greece, as the song seems to capitalize on a systematic effort made throughout the 1950s and the 1960s. Remember, the song, Acropolis Adieu, was recorded at the end of this period in the early 1970s, right when the post-war world was about to change once again. I turn to this song as it brings together many of the common stereotypes coined in the years and the films before it, but also because it anticipates much of what was to follow. From Greece's first ever Eurovision Song Contest entry in 1974 with Ligo Krasi, Ligo Thalassa και τ' αγόρι μου, a bit of wine, a bit of sea, and my boyfriend, introduced by a long stretch of la la la's again, to the rather hopeless attempt to promote in more recent years a cinematic flop like Donald Petrie's My Life in Ruins from 2009 as a showcase for Greek tourism, starring Greek-Canadian actress and screenwriter Nia Vardalos and Greek heartthrob of the hour, Alexis Georgoulis. The film is a romantic comedy set among and inside the ruins of classical Greece, promoting the four S's the country is best known for: sun, sea, sex, and souvlaki. Ah, and of course, Sirtaki as well, in which case Greece's four S's are five, suggesting the Greeks' apparent ability to break into dancing anytime they feel happy, sad, or just feel like it. This feeling like it is what the Greeks themselves are known to have been calling kephi, an attitude or a state of being which in the Vardalos film is variously translated as passion, life force, or less helpfully, mojo. The film's other cliches, old and tired even by the film's own time, included the country's backwardness, the Greeks' laziness and dislike of hygiene and sanitation, the disregard of the law as opposed to their love for song, for long coffee breaks. In the words of Erato Bassea, who studied My Life in Ruins in a paper published in this country 10 years ago, The film thus becomes implicated in cultural politics and generates a new commercial image for Greece. One, we could add, however, that was created a few decades prior. It is a cultural image certainly including classical art and the contemporary politics around it, from the integrity and visibility of Greek archaeological finds to the return of the Parthenon marbles to Athens, one, to be sure, created by Western visitors to the country for their own intents and purposes. So let us revisit those exciting years that seem to have formulated Greece as we still know it, and perhaps love to hate. On June 5th, 1955, during a press conference at Athens's emblematic Grand Bretagne Hotel, the Greeks were informed that 20th century Fox, the unrivaled colossus of American cinema at the time, had decided to film Boy on a Dolphin on the Greek island of Hydra. Based on a novel by David Divine, the movie was meant, according to producer Samuel G. Engel, who led the conference, to make Greece known to America, a plan apparently conceived by the company's president, Greek-born Spiros Kouras, in collaboration with John Purifoy, once the American ambassador to Athens. Following a series of dead-end deliberations and false starts, Italian upcoming actress of the time, Sophia Loren, was cast in the leading role of Phaedra, a local island girl making her living through sponge diving. Alan Ladd and Clifton Webb were cast as the film's two leading men, while a lesser role was given to Greek actor Alexis Minotis, then residing in Hollywood and a friend of Skouras. Minotis had allegedly encouraged Konstantinos Karamanlis, who, as Greece's on and off prime minister in the turbulent 1950s, was looking for ways to boost the country's tourist economy, to get in touch with Skouras in the first place. Karamanlis, apparently, met with Skouras, and soon enough, Boy on a Dolphin was actually happening. The movie was directed by Romanian-born Jan Negulescu, already acclaimed for his earlier work, including the 1954 hit, Three Coins in the Fountain, that one filmed in Rome. The boy's storyline brings together most of the trademark qualities that were later used to repackage Greece for the global tourist market in the 1960s and the 1970s, and we're already able to locate in Acropolis Adieu in the beginning of this lecture, as an exotic seascape of eternal summer, where local girls are exquisitely sensual, though modest and kind, and men tend to be short and dark-skinned, simple-minded, rather unsightly, and terribly, terribly uncivilized. More often than not, ancient ruins, and less so, Byzantine chapels, may be seen to dot the background, forming a large part of the cultural and social life of the natives. And at least in the case of this particular scenario, classical antiquities may be found in the country's dry land or lying on the bed of its deep blue sea. This markedly American way of viewing Greece was explicitly tailored for a wider middle-class audience happy to consume culture as commodity and enjoy international traveling as a new form of leisure. Goaded by an emerging desire to commodify the country and its heritage, Greek authorities were typically happy to oblige in return for greater international visibility for the country and considerable successes for their own financial plans. The Greek tourist industry, as a result, was spearheaded by a desire on the one hand to make the country appear as a land of ancient splendors, a heterotopia of ruins, so to speak, and on the other, as a state on a fast track towards modernization. You say he's only a statue, and what can a statue achieve? And yet, while I'm gazing at you, my heart tells my head to believe. This is from the title song sung by Julie London. We hear this song in the film's title sequence, in lyrics by Paul Francis Webster, put to music by Greek composer Takis Morakis. The song's Greek version, Tin Afto Pou To Lene Agapi, what is this thing they call love, also heard in the movie, has now become an all-time classic of Greek music. 7 minutes into the film, Phaedra discovers the boy the storyline is all about, that is, the statue of a toddler, seemingly made of gold, riding a dolphin, this one cast in bronze. The pair come from a shipwreck, which Phaedra discovers by accident in one of her dives. The local doctor, an alcoholic Briton, identifies the find based on an old myth and some actual artifacts from the island of Delos. In fact, the statue, as you can see it in the photograph here, ostensibly discovered by Phaedra, combines the so-called jockey, an actual archaeological find from an ancient shipwreck now on display in the National Museum in Athens, and the very well-known image of a dolphin from a Hellenistic mosaic found in an ancient house on Delos. Next, in the movie, we find Phaedra in Athens, where American archaeologists are busy rebuilding the store of Attalos at the Agora, and one would think giving the Parthenon an once-over as well. As colonialist stereotypes go, from the script and the way the Athens scenes are filmed, one would have assumed that the Americans pretty much ran Greek archaeology at the time. In a story, therefore, filled with Greek antiquities and their dim predicament, either in the hands of ignorant Greek peasants and criminal Albanians, or as valuable loot desired by suspicious foreigners, the movie never really deviates from its true purpose, to advertise Greece as a tourist destination, filled with breathtaking sights, though a country thoroughly modernized as well. From its title sequence, a ludicrously random presentation of the islands of Greece, featuring extensive scenes from Rhodes and Mykonos, otherwise unrelated to the plot, to prolonged shots of the Agora, the Acropolis, Epidaurus, and Meteora, the film reads like a documentary about Greek archaeological treasures, that is, when the camera does not dwell too much on the country's motorways, freshly built at the time, some newly modernized restaurants, and its cosmopolitan tourist resorts. The vision of modernization incidentally makes a recurring appearance in posters promoting Greek tourism at about the same time, following posters of the 1930s where Greek spa towns like Loutraki or Edipsos are depicted as modernized resorts of their times with modern buildings, motorways, etc. The promotion of a modernized Greece would return with a vengeance in the 1960s when, side by side with the predictable classical and medieval antiquities, we find direct references to a novel, younger, more modern and cosmopolitan aspect of the country. See, for example, this 1969 poster titled Yachting in Greece, an unnamed beach, however recognizable as Vouliagmeni Bay in Attica, a bikini-clad girl sunbathing on the deck of a pleasure boat. And in the distance, an austerely modern, newly built hotel, its pristine lines and cubic forms holding their own within a rather indifferent landscape. This is the time when Greece is in the throes of reconstruction, under the encouraging but uncompromising gaze of the West, acquiring the necessary infrastructure so that the beauties of the Greek landscape, natural or built, would become more easily accessible to an increasingly demanding international public. I should also remark that in the 1950s, roughly 8 out of 10 official tourist posters depict classical or, much less frequently, medieval antiquities, or at least contain derivative references to them. Indeed, in a 1959 poster, a black figure crater serves as a vase for a bunch of chrysanthemums, or daisies, actually. The ratio is kept unchanged in the 1960s and even through the 1970s, where, however, there is an increasing effort to showcase Greece as a modernized holiday resort. Greek tourist posters demonstrate that the 1950s begin to capitalize at long last on the systematic effort to promote Greece as a heterotopia of ruins, as the other place of the world community's collective imagination, where visitors can enjoy a live experience of the classical, relieved of its historical burden. Archaeological sites restored and cleared of unacceptable interventions or additions, such as any non-Greek crusader or Ottoman antiquities, classical ruins, Byzantine churches and monasteries, traditional settlements and neoclassical mansions all add to produce the image of a land with an extraordinary heritage which it labors successfully to safeguard and preserve. And this is precisely the narrative supporting another Greek effort to promote its tourist wares, the Greco-Swedish 1968 production, Apollo Goes on Holiday, written and directed by Yorgos Kalinakis, as a modern fairy tale recounting the chance meeting of a Swedish prince with a beautiful Greek tourist guide and the charming love affair that ensues. Filmed yet again in Greece's key archaeological sites and in many ways anticipating Nia Vardalos's My Life in Ruins 40 years later, Apollo, which as you can see from its posters was distributed internationally in many guises, strikes its contemporary viewer as a naive, blindingly optimistic approach to Greece's mass touristification, the impossible dialogue between locals and visitors, the inevitable gap between the Mediterranean East and the Nordic West, the challenges and pitfalls of modernization. Still, the attractive female tourist guide in the film is very eloquent about Kefi and can prove to be a quite competent Sirtaki dancer as well, especially when some classical ruins happen to dot the background. To return to the foreign films made in and about Greece, the contrived juxtaposition between a refined middle class of mostly men of the world and the ignorant, naive, and brutish Greek peasants was, as I already pointed out, to become an international trademark affecting the way cinema portrayed the country and its people. A more recent and most celebrated example is Phyllida Lloyd's international 2008 hit, Mamma Mia, which seems to be following a long historical tradition of representing Greece as a place for foreigners to find themselves, from Lord Byron and Leonard Cohen to Shirley Valentine. Though the word Greece is mentioned in the film only once, would you believe it, the landscape is always there to behold, even if the film's Greek characters remain silent throughout and seemingly stuck in time. Mamma Mia, indeed, remains a movie interested in the myth of Greece, but not in any Greeks in particular. Like their island, ludicrously named Kalokeri, summer, in the film, that is, a place coming to life only during the tourist season, the islanders, too, are utilized as a mere decor to the adventures of the story's foreign protagonists. Often enough, though, Greek involvement was more noticeable, rendering the entire enterprise into a self-colonization project of sorts. If Boy on a Dolphin featured only one significant Greek credit, that is Morakis's for the instantly successful title song, other, somewhat later productions would count a bit more on the natives themselves. Melina Mercouri, most notably, was perhaps cast as an anti-Lorraine in Never on Sunday, released by United Artists in 1960. Directed by Jules Dassin, an acclaimed American director, and already at the time Melina's devoted partner and later lifelong husband, the film was conceived as a vehicle for her as much as for Greece. In Dassin's own script, Melina, called Ilia in the film, playing a Piraeus prostitute famously resting only on Sundays, is thought to represent the purity that was Greece. This is from the script. In the eyes of Homer Thrace, an American classicist and intellectual played by Dassin in the movie, who came to Greece to find the truth, as he says, Ilia needs to reconnect with Greece's glorious past and the truth lying in the writings of the Greek philosophers. She needs to embrace reason instead of fantasy, morality instead of immorality, as Homer is saying. Even though Never on Sunday remains indecisive about its own agenda, it seems to recycle a stereotypical belief, also shared by many Greek intellectuals since at least the interwar years, that there exists an irreparable divide between East and West, affecting Greece's standing with both. The film, moreover, suggests, as Boy on a Dolphin also did in its own way, that Greece's classical past, coveted by the West, who treats it as its own intellectual genealogy, often clashes with its people's Balkan or Eastern Mediterranean present, which rather defines Greece as part of the Orient. And of course, this is a discourse well studied by now by many Hellenists, including Michael Hertzfeld, Stathis Gourgouris, Vangelis Kalotichos, Dimitris Papanikolaou, and many more. Never on Sunday's international success helped consolidate these stereotypes. Melina won the award for Best Actress at the 1960 Cannes Film Festival, an award which she shared with Jeanne Moreau for the film 7 Days, 7 Nights by Peter Brook, and was nominated for an Oscar, while the title song by Manos Hadzidakis, which did succeed in receiving the Academy Award for that year, went on to become the international hit I described in the beginning of my talk. Alongside Theodorakis's famous Sirtaki dance from Zorba, it came to typify the way foreigners saw Greece, and even the way the Greeks chose to represent themselves to themselves and others, especially when gains from tourism were to be had. It is certainly no coincidence that these two songs are indeed quoted, both audibly and visibly, in My Life in Ruins, in a sort of self-reflexive and perhaps also ironic way of explaining to an early 21st century international audience what the ruins of Greece do, in fact, consist of. For in both The Boy on a Dolphin and Never on Sunday, archaeophilia, the love of antiquity and antiquities, is what Greece's visitors expect from the country and its people. And what they feel free to express, they feel free to express their dismay when the locals fail to share Western enthusiasm for their own past. At the same time, however, both female protagonists in the two films, Phaedra and Ilia, are shown to harbor an embodied, sensorial, and quasi-metaphysical relationship with the material antiquities of their land. While Boy on a Dolphin's Phaedra initially collaborates with an American smuggler hoping to sell a Greek national treasure, as the film's archaeologist calls the statue, she then comes to her senses and realizes that her valuable find must remain in Greece while she surrenders herself to the attractive archaeologist played by Alan Ladd. Ilya, on the other hand, although blissfully ignorant of the actual content of Greek mythology, is shown emotionally enjoying performances of Greek drama, which he thoroughly misunderstands, and then seems completely at ease discussing her ideas about Greek philosophy, such as they are, during a night stroll through the magnificently filmed site of the Athenian Acropolis. In films like Boy on a Dolphin and Never on Sunday, despite their many differences, Greece is stereotypically portrayed as part of the Orient, a place isolated from the global mainstream, as a place requiring Western attention and also open to it, inviting a Western reconstruction of its classical materialities as a way to reach redemption under the unforgiving gaze of the West. Like in Acropolis Adieu, the song, where a male traveler to Athens bids farewell to his local girlfriend in the face of the city's emblematic landmark, Phaedra and Ilya are in the two movies cast as competing metaphors for Greece, significantly gendered female, an unforgettable locale where no one wants to reside for too long. Yet the success of the two movies, as well as a few others, such as The Guns of Navarone from 1961, and of course the massively successful Zorba, the Greek in 1964, meant that Greece was in fact revisited. Rhodes, Mykonos, Attica, with its scenic coastline, Hydra itself, were soon to become international tourist destinations, a development that defined their cultural identity to the present day. By the time Dassin and Mercouri filmed part of their new movie, Phaedra, in Hydra in 1962, the island was virtually unrecognizable, although the heterotopic exoticism constructed with Boy on a Dolphin remained. Now the island comes across both as deservedly cosmopolitan and refreshingly modernized. Phaedra, however, is once again about archaeophilia, among other Greek vices, such as, quite tellingly, adultery within the family. The storyline itself, scripted by Greek novelist Margarita Liberaki, is based on Hippolytus by Euripides, as well as Racine's Phaedra. And thus, the film manages to combine ancient Greek bathos with Melina's acting hyperbole. Although the film was neither a commercial nor an artistic success, and has aged rather badly in the 60-odd years since its production, it still makes a good case study of the way Greek intellectuals and their friends constructed an image for the country and its people that relied on the exceptionality that was Greece. For no apparent reason, the film's title sequence features prolonged shots of the Parthenon frieze as exhibited in the British Museum. And when Melina first meets Anthony Perkins in the movie, he is cast as a stepson and future lover, further down the storyline, they meet in that museum's Davin Gallery, beautifully photographed against the Parthenon sculptures. This might well anticipate Melina's later campaign as Greek Minister for Culture for the return of the marbles to Greece. At any rate, within the movie itself, it stands as a reminder of the burden of Greekness upon Greece's modern inhabitants, once again narrated as a blessing in disguise. In the context of the film, classical art is portrayed as Greece's own very soul, an affordance Greeks cannot imagine themselves without, and at the same time a quality residing deep in the cultural make of the West, an affinity the West cannot ignore. In many ways, Phaedra seems to be anticipating the cultural argument presented by Acropolis Adieu less than a decade later, in order to reverse it, however. If Greece is the Western imagination's summer fling, then this Greek summer is eternal indeed. Let's dance. It is also interesting to note that in all these narratives, Greece is invariably cast as the West's easternmost frontier, partly and perhaps irreparably Oriental itself, while no other, neither local nor foreigner, seems to be paying any attention to anything or anyone further east. Casting themselves as Western, which more often than not simply meant modernized, the Greeks of the time felt their only target audience was European, where from came cultural acceptance, and American, guaranteeing financial stability and growth. Even in terms of tourism, you see, there was still a long way to go before the first Japanese or Chinese tourist groups were to ever set foot on a Greek archaeological site. The extent to which these narratives about Greekness affected the Greeks themselves is difficult to determine. On some occasions, like when on November 8, 1956, thongs of youngsters disturbed Sophia Loren's shooting day at Pasalimani in Piraeus, yelling and cheering mockingly at the crew. They were shouting, "Sophia, Sophia." Locals decided to behave like insubordinate natives. In other cases, they seemed happier to accommodate. Greek cinema, at the same time, was able to comment on Idra's newly found cosmopolitanism in its own way. Michael Kakoyannis's A Girl in Black, also filmed in 1956, shows an under-modernized Hydra and a much more somber light, with no ancient statues in sight, but with the burden of Greek tragedy and a particularly Greek sense of narrative fatalism, quite obvious in its plot. These movies were being shot at the same time. Here, the cultural and social rift is between city folk, represented by the urbanized, Europeanized, suave young man visiting the island, and the islanders, some of whom take us back to the crass brutality portrayed in Boy on a Dolphin and elsewhere. Though others, and notably the film's female lead, are meant to express a nobility long lost in the Greek past, which resonates with the audience as particularly Hellenic. Thankfully, the film's protagonists, Ellie Lambetti and Dimitris Horn, came from Athens and not Hollywood. And this contrast remains obvious throughout. Quite tellingly, however, the couple's first scene in the movie happens on the very spot on the island's harbor where the two protagonists of Boy on a Dolphin had shared their last scene together, which was a passionate kissing scene, nonetheless. Although Greece remained grateful to the disorderly armies of tourists, vagabonds, and hippies who kept arriving summer after summer to find themselves in the bars and the beaches of Mykonos, Santorini, Ivra, and Rhodes, some Greeks reserved the right to make fun with this. In a refreshingly satirical sequence, From Eftichia's Shooters, Gabritis Eftichia's, a Greek situation comedy filmed by Socrates Kapsaskis in 1962, the same year Phaedra was released, we're treated to a panorama of Ivra as a playground for the Greek and international 60s. A crowd of well-to-do Athenians spend their summer vacation in a house suspiciously similar to the one where Melina had her fateful affair with her stepson in Phaedra. Actually, the two movies share the same patio in different parts of the same house. The island is filled with polyglot plein air painters and scantily clad sunbathers, traditional sights and modern sounds. No music by Hadjidakis or Theodorakis is to be heard, however. Only Voulez-vous cha-cha avec moi by Tito Rodriguez, mockingly warbled by Georgia Vasiliadou in the title role of aging Eftichia, who has come to Ivra to socialize exclusively with foreigners as she cannot stand the locals, as she says. As a place to dream of visiting, a modern heterotopia of ancient ruins and eternal myths. By the end of the 1960s, Greece was at long last ready to embrace an ever-changing an ever more globalized world, as the place everyone wants to be, or at least reside, till September comes. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Will Wootton, and my role here is as the head of the Department of Classics, but my main duty is to give a vote of thanks specifically to you, Professor Dimitris Plantzos, but to a number of others here. I start with you, Dimitris, thanking you ever so much for this rich and vibrant evocation of the construction of a specific stereotypical view of Greece, of Greeks and others too, as well as giving us an insight into the agendas underlying them. I wish we sort of had a series of movie nights now where you could guide us through these and we could discuss each of these films in turn. Maybe that's something for the future. Unfortunately, this evening there are no questions, so you'll have to bring those to Professor Plantzos individually. But it made me think of the last opportunity I had to go to Greece back in 2017, and the images of Robert McCabe that were then on exhibition under the title of Chronography at the Archaeological Society of Athens. He was there in 1954, I think it was. And those black and white images give a similar idea of construction of Greece, but a very different evocation, I think, to these colorful and more exuberant images that we see before us. And of course, the Archaeological Society of Athens had played such a major role in the earlier conservation and restoration of Greece's monuments. In 2017, it was celebrating its 180th anniversary, set up in 1837, only 7 years after the foundation of the Greek state, so right at those foundational moments. It made me think about the sort of intersection between the sort of archaeological documentation that Michael referred to and the intervention of foreign archaeologists, but working in collaboration with Greek archaeologists too. Again, quite a different picture to what we see here, and one that I think would be interesting to explore further. And I'm very grateful to Professor Plantzos for doing that. I have fond memories of sitting many years ago in the Ashmolean Museum, reading his book on Hellenistic engraved gems, so it is a sincere and great honor to be standing here thanking him today. I would also like to extend our gratitude to Professor Michael Squire, who did the introduction, but has been with us at King's since 2011, so now more than 10 years. It is with great sadness that we will see his departure to Cambridge to become the 8th Lawrence Professor of Classical Archaeology there at the end of this year. It will be a great loss to us, but a huge win for Cambridge. In fact, coming back to Robert McCabe, his second trip to Greece was at the instigation of Professor Alan Wace, who was the second professor, a Lawrence Professor of Classical Archaeology. So there's a nice sort of connections here that we can see. We will miss you, Michael, and we are hugely grateful to everything you've done, not least in bringing Sandra Rosignoli, the donor of the Jamie Memorial Rumble Fund, bringing her donation to King's and carrying out the management of this fund with such vigor. And I think it's extraordinary to see that What's happened in the years since 2013 when this fund started? And we're grateful to you, Michael, but also obviously specifically to you, Sandra. I think back also to the time in 2011, 2012, when you were an MA student at King's, and think about it with great fondness. And we are very grateful to everything you've done, to the wonderful opportunities that you have given to our students, and to yearly through this event to a wider audience. So thank you very much, Sandra. And we have every intention of continuing to develop the Jamie Rumble Memorial Fund in the years to come. And that brings me to the CHS, the Center for Hellenic Studies, and Professor Honda van Steen. Thank you to the CHS. Thank you to you for all the work you put into organizing the events this year, but also to taking the students on those trips to Greece. And as Michael indicated, next year, Honda will once again lead the Rumble trip, this also to Greece, this time under the auspices of a module called Adventures in Greek Drama. And just as I want more movie nights with Professor Plantzos, so would I love to come on that trip too. In addition, I'd like to thank those who have put so much time and effort into organizing this evening, in particular, Ruth Denton and Peter Swallow, everyone else at KCL venues, and those who have kindly given up their evenings to work behind the bar tonight. Thank you to you. And finally, thank you to all of you for coming this evening, for spending time here with us and enjoying the wonderful presentation by Professor Plantzos. It is very clear that you have given us an evening which is incredibly full, not at all empty, and you've helped us to forget all our other worries. Thank you very much.